in the grand theater of India's struggle for freedom. A powerful question echoes through our history. How did India's most skilled lawyers, trained in the art of justice, become the key freedom fighters in the fight for freedom? In 1885, the formation of Indian National Congress marked the dawn of a new era in the Indian freedom struggle. This period saw the rise of moderate leaders, many of whom were distinguished lawyers like Dadabhai Nauroji, Surendranath Banerjee, Madan Mohan Malviye, and Motilal Nehru. These leaders, with their commitment to constitutionalism, advocated for civil rights and opportunities within the framework of the law, embodying the spirit of peaceful advocacy and reform. Their early efforts laid the groundwork for a structured resistance against colonial rule. The peak of resistance was observed in the 1905, at the time of the partition of Bengal. These ignited flames of resistance gave rise to a more assertive wave of leaders with the legal background, such as Bal Gangadhar Tilak, Lala Lajpat Rai, and Bipin Chandra Pal. Tilak, a lawyer, famously asserted that Swaraj is my birthright, advocating for direct action, and Swaraj, that is, self-rule. Alongside him, Lala Lajpat Rai and Bipin Chandra Pal, also known as Lal Bal Pal Trio, used their oratory and legal skills to inspire a generation towards active resistance. The flames of resistance soon reached the courtroom in 1908. In Alipur bomb case, an eminent lawyer, Chittaranjan Das, defended Aurobindo Ghosh and 37 other revolutionaries. His work underscored the patriotism that fueled India's legal warriors, earning him the title Desh Bandhu, that means friend of the nation. He continued to leverage his legal expertise to defend nationalists and revolutionaries, including the infamous Dhaka conspiracy case of 1910-11. The introduction of Morley Minto reforms in 1909 led to intensified demands for Swaraj, with increased extremist and revolutionary activities. The situation worsened with the Rowlatt Act of 1919, which permitted imprisonment without trial, sparking widespread protest and strikes. Among the leaders who stood against this oppressive legislation was Saifuddin Kichlu, a lawyer and passionate nationalist. Saifuddin Kichlu was not only a vocal critic of the Rowlatt Act, but also a founding leader of the Naujawan Bharat Sabha. As resistance intensified, the return of Mahatma Gandhi from South Africa in 1915 brought a new dimension to the struggle. Gandhi, a barrister by profession, had returned from South Africa after successfully leading a satyagraha against racial discrimination. In India, he quickly made his mark through the Champaran and Kheda satyagrahas by leading the protest against unjust landlord practices. He led the various movements starting from the Champaran to the Quit India movement, urging Indians to peacefully defy British laws. Rajendra Prasad, who later became India's first president, was also involved in the Champaran movement. Alongside Gandhi, Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel, another legal luminary, mobilized peasants and common folk, using his legal expertise to negotiate and challenge British authority. Sardar Patel also presided over the Karachi Congress in 1931, focusing on fundamental rights and a secular India. In December 1921, Mahatma Gandhi took on executive leadership of the Indian National Congress, opening its membership to the masses and spearheading the non-cooperation movement. The movement intensified with the formation of the Swaraj Party by Chittaranjan Das and Motilal Nehru, advocating for political change from within the British-controlled councils. In 1928, the Nehru Report proposed dominion status, leading to the Congress demand for complete independence at the Lahore Congress in 1929. World War II brought new challenges and opportunities for India's freedom fighters. When three INA officers, Shahnawaz Khan, Prem Kumar Sehgal, and Gurbaksh Singh Dhillon, were tried for treason, Indian lawyers played a crucial role in their defense. A defense committee including 17 advocates like Bhulabhai Desai and Kailashnath Karju represented them in a historic court-martial at the Red Fort in 1945. These lawyers' successful defiance led to the release of the officers, marking a significant victory and demonstrating the influential role of the legal profession in India's struggle for independence. In the aftermath of the World War II, Britain's Labour Party, led by Prime Minister Clement Attlee, showed support for India's independence. The Cabinet Mission of 1946 proposed an interim government and the formation of a constituent assembly to draft a new constitution. Jawaharlal Nehru, a prominent leader of the Indian National Congress, led the interim government. The Constituent Assembly, formed in July 1946, elected Dr. Rajendra Prasad as its president and appointed. As India's struggle for freedom neared its climax, the task of shaping its future fell to patriotic leaders like Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, an eminent jurist and social reformer. Entrusted with drafting the Indian Constitution, Ambedkar's work was driven by a deep commitment to justice and equality. Alongside him, Jawaharlal Nehru, also a lawyer, envisioned democratic and secular India. Their collaborative efforts laid the foundation for a nation built on principles of justice, liberty, and fraternity. On January 26, 1950, India adopted its new constitution. With Dr. Rajendra Prasad becoming the first president of India and C. Rajgopalachari, the first Indian Governor General, Patel, Nehru, and Rajgopalachari formed a triumvirate that governed India during its early years as an independent nation. As India awoke to freedom on the midnight of August 14, 1947, the contributions of lawyers and jurists stood out in shaping a nation founded on liberty, equality, and justice. Their legacy in the struggle for India's independence remains unparalleled. Do you know any more lawyers who contributed to the Indian freedom struggle? Tell us in the comment section. Jai Hind!